Let me turn to education for a minute. Sal, I want to bring you in here. Let me read from a report from the President's Council of Economic Advisors. It says global spending on education is $3.9 trillion, or 5.6% of planetary GDP. America spends the most, about $1.3 trillion a year, yet the U.S. ranks 25th out of 34 countries in math, 17th in science, 14th in reading. About a fifth of our American teenagers do not have basic competence in science. 23% cannot use math in daily life. So that's a lot of numbers, but it gives an idea, obviously, that's not great. So what's wrong with the way we teach in this country?
I some people are surprised. I'm actually not as hard on America as sometimes the statistics or the press have it. I mean, you know, I always get into arguments with some of my family from the Indian subcontinent. They're like, oh, the kids here, you know, all our kids can, you know, do integrals by the time they're six and whatever else. And I point out that, well, what percentage of the people in Calcutta or Dhaka were even in school? So you're really comparing our 50th percentile to really that 95th percentile. And if you, you know, whenever you do the country rankings, there's frankly no country that you could compare the U.S. to that is as large and as diverse. I mean, it's not a Finland, it's not a Singapore, it's not a South Korea. I mean, those aren't fair comparisons. So I guess if I have a bone to pick, it's not necessarily with the American system, it's actually with the global system. The global system is, you know, I write about this a lot in my book. It's a system we inherited from the Prussians. They were the first to say, hey, let's do mass public education, which was a very powerful idea. But they said, well, how do we do it at a kind of an economic way? And said, well, how do we do anything in an economic way? It was the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. We can batch things together. We can have a process. We can apply certain procedures. Kids go together at the same pace, try to apply information to them. At some point, we can sort the oranges. These oranges are going to go to Whole Foods. These oranges are going to get squeezed for orange juice. And I don't know if that's a good analogy or not. But I'll let Clay decide. And then the U.S., Japan, the other, you know, it's no coincidence. These are the first major industrial powers kind of inherited the same system. And it was really to design, to produce a workforce for the Industrial Revolution, to people who knew just enough to work in a factory or whatever else. And now we are looking for people who can be creative, who can think of new ideas, who can be disruptive. And the irony here is, I think America, regardless of its education system, does it better than anywhere else on the planet. That if anything, it's not about what's wrong with the American system. It's actually, in my mind, how can we make it more American? How can we make global systems more American? You know, despite everything that's going on in our school system. I think bunnies are cute too.
fishing for claps.
But it really is. I mean, regardless of what's happening, if you look at, you know, there's all this doom and gloom about America. But if you go like 50 years ago, 60 years ago, you looked at where are the most innovative companies in the world. Yeah, there were some in California, there were some on the East Coast, there were some in Europe, there were some all over the planet. And if you look as we get closer and closer to the present, the concentration has frankly gotten more and more concentrated about 20 miles around where we are right now. And frankly, this is, in my mind, the most American part of America. In my mind, what we need to do with our school system is, okay, at any point in history, the ideal was always students learn at their own pace, it's focused on the student, master concepts before moving on. That's always been the gold standard. That was just never feasible, never practical. You'd have to have a private tutor for every student. Now, with technology, I think you can get to that standard. And we are starting to prototype this in schools and see really great results. And the irony here is we're using technology to make the classroom more interactive. Interactive not with technology, interactive with humans, with students talking to students, students doing the projects and whatever else. And so the future I'd like to see, I could talk obviously for hours about this, but a competency-based future. Right now our school system is seat time-based. At the university level, it's literally credit hours. Mm-hmm. I think it's, you know, students learn at their own pace. When they go to a class, it's not lecture-based anymore. It's literally peer-to-peer instruction, multi-age group cohorts. You could actually liberate what happens within classrooms. You could have multiple classrooms together, teachers teaching together. And when students graduate, they don't just have a certain GPA. They don't just have a Bachelor of Arts or a Bachelor of Science. They have a portfolio of skills that they've proven competency in. They have peer assessment on how good of a teacher and a mentor they were, which is an important, that's a more important skill than learning to factor a polynomial. And they have a portfolio of creative works, which is completely unaddressed right now, but this is something that every employer actually cares about.